You don't think of I love art, you think I have to do art. I don't have any choice in the matter. You know, if I can't do the art, I'll just do doodles everywhere I go, you know, or graffiti or something like that. But yeah, it's a compulsion. You have to do it. You don't have a choice in the matter. And you can't do it unless you're in that frame of mind that you have to do it. Until I built up a little bit of money, then I quit the job and paint. That's how I lived my life. I never ever intended to take a job for longer than it took me to make enough money to go out on my own. When I was in high school, I already was determined to go to art school and be an artist. And when I graduated, I got a two-year scholarship to the Fort Wayne Art School, it was a two-year program. So that made it possible for me to go there, and I did. And that's where I met Tom. We were in the same high school together, but we didn't know each other. He was a year or two ahead of me. And for some reason, the grades don't mix in high school. You stay within your own grade. But afterwards, when we both worked for the same theater company, one woman, Mrs. Quimby, owned the four or five best theaters in Fort Wayne, and Tom and I both needed a job, so we both got one there, and that's where our friendship began, working for the same place. I knew of him before that, but we weren't friends. My father was a very kind of a quiet man who didn't try to dictate anything. And didn't, you know, but he was, you know, he was at home, so you saw him every day. But he didn't like tell you what to do or what to learn or anything like that. And my mother, she thought that I should get a factory job. Fort Wayne had about 24 factories, you know, Magnavox and International Harvester and General Electric, and one after another. These are big, important factories. And that's what the town was. It was a factory town, and that's where people worked, and that's where they lived. And all the students I went to school with in grade school were, their parents worked in factories. In high school, it was a little different because high school drew in students from all over the town, but not just the neighborhood you lived in. I didn't have a middle class family. I had a lower class poor family, and they don't direct their children the way the middle class people do. The middle class people have plans for their children. Poor people don't. Whatever you want to do, try to do it. It's your life. So yeah, but I had been drawing and painting since I was a little child, you know, even before I went to school, and all through school. So it was no surprise to anybody that I was going to do that. And then I got the scholarship, so that cinched it. There was no turning back then. It was a great breakthrough for me as a teenager to discover that the Greek world was pro-homosexual and the Roman world was tolerant of it. So that was a big thing, because the Catholic world certainly wasn't. But you know, Alexander, for instance, was, the Macedonians are Greek, and he was in the Greek culture. Aristotle was his teacher. And all his life he was, had this one lover that he stayed with all of the time. That painting I call Patroclus, that's who that is. I know from my own experience that I am gay because I am gay. I mean, I was never anything else. Not for a minute was I ever confused about that. I tried to not be gay when I was, you know, younger. But I didn't try that hard because I knew it was impossible. Well, you ask how I heard about Black Mountain. I heard about it when I was in art school, and one of our teachers, Elizabeth Eddy, recommended that we write to them and get a brochure, which I say we, Tom Field and I, and we did that, and then I forgot about it because I got drafted, went to Korea, and all those things passed. But in the meantime, Tom, who was in the Army for 2 years, he got out, 2 years ahead of me, and I was in the Air Force for 4 years. So when I got out of the Air Force in New York, I thought I was going to go to a commercial art school in New York City, Parsons, as a matter of fact. But when I got there, it seemed rather juvenile, everything. You know, it was like extended high school. So I didn't like that. So I said, well, I'll go to Black Mountain and visit Tom. And I had no intention of going there to study. But I did. I got out of the train and I went to Black Mountain, and immediately I wanted to be there. First of all, well, it was a very serious art place and high art place. It wasn't, beginner's art or anything like that. Everybody was a graduate school level of art. And you could live right there in the campus, and they accepted the GI Bill in full payment. The Korean GI Bill did not pay much of our education, but Black Mountain decided that they would accept what they got. And so I was able to go because I couldn't have gone otherwise. There's no occupations in the mountains of North Carolina. There's nothing you can do to make a living. So I did that. I was glad. I've always been glad I did it because I met the adult people of my life there. And from there, the others have followed. I wasn't there long. I was only there 3 semesters. 55 and 56. There was nothing derogatory about being gay at Black Mountain or in San Francisco. In the Air Force, it just didn't come up. They never mentioned it. Nobody ever mentioned it. It wasn't a topic that was ever discussed. I wasn't there long. I was only there 3 semesters or 3 quarters. Black Mountain had a year of 4 quarters, but the summer quarter was a art fair more than a teaching school, and the other 3 quarters were teaching. So when you hear that all of these people who were famous people, they didn't go there as students. They showed up at one of the summer festivals, and they claimed they had been to Black Mountain. Well, they have, There's nothing wrong with it. But that's why there are so many people who claim to be from Black Mountain, because of the summer festivals. And they were very popular because Black Mountain was extremely well known in New York City. I mean, John Cage went there. Taught there. Franz Klein taught there, and also de Kooning graduated Black Mountain. When you graduate, you had to apply. You had to call in an outsider to evaluate you. And so students who were, that was the, the period of abstract expressionism, that had broken through about 6 years earlier. And by that time, that's all that there was in the world of painting. That's all there was. There wasn't anything else. So anyway, people would call in a famous New York artist, and he would come down and spend a few days and evaluate him and decide whether you were graduate material or not. Well, I was studying painting. I was a painter and studying painting. I also studied acting because that was the class that was offered. The school was very small. There were about 6 teachers and 13 students. So I even studied music, and I'm totally unmusical. But just because the teachers were there and we could do those things, I liked the acting very much. But it didn't lead to anything because I didn't pursue it. The life of an actor seemed to be impossibly difficult. So I didn't try. I like it, but you have to get a part first. And, you know, in the theater, it's you're competing with everybody else who wants that part. So, Blackbone Joe Fiore was the painting teacher, and we studied with him. I think we had two meetings, group meetings, twice a week to discuss each other's paintings. Basically, that's what we were doing. And then we all had our own studios. Blackbone had lots of room, and so you had a place to live, and a place to cook, and a place to do your work, and everybody did. It wasn't that special at all. I tried to live in New York City because that's where all the painters were, and all the galleries were. You know, there are no galleries in California worth bothering with. To this day, there might be one and two in LA, but all the galleries that count are in New York City. So I tried to live there after I finished my education. But I couldn't do it. The city was just too crowded, too, you almost felt like you were never outside at all. Even when you're outside, you felt like you're inside. Because all these tall buildings blocked out the sky. And so unless you went around looking up at the sky straight up, you don't even see it. So I didn't like that at all. So I went back to San Francisco, which I'd gone to San Francisco when I left Black Mountain. I took off the summer quarter, is what I did, and came to San Francisco because I had an offer of an Air Force friend who wanted to start a theater company. And he said he had it all set up, and we had done a play together in the Air Force. It was a sort of a big deal. And so I liked him very much. I trusted him. And he said, come and, you know, spend the summer. So that's what I did. But that wasn't true. He didn't have anything set up. And there was no theater at all. So I decided, I got a job with General Electric as a clerk. And went on from there. Yeah. In those days, it's unbelievable how inexpensive it was to live in San Francisco. I mean, in North Beach, the better apartments were $55, and the basic immigrant apartments were $35. And they were all, every block had two or three available. There wasn't any difficulty in finding this. All you had to do in San Francisco at that time was walk around and look for empty windows. You saw an empty window, you knocked on the door. And usually you were welcome, and if you liked the place, you took it. Even on top of Knob Hill, a very lavish apartment, Tom and I looked for it together because we thought we could afford a bigger space if we went together. And this big floor-through apartment with a maid's room and a floor bell in the dining room to summon the cook or whatever, and you know, big wonderful bedrooms, top of Knob Hill, that was $110 a month. When I arrived, the gay bar scene was very active in all different neighborhoods. There was nothing like the Castro. The gays were scattered all over the place where they could find an apartment. And they didn't have their... Well, we did have our own restaurants. Like in North Beach, there was a bar restaurant called the Paper Doll. And that was a gay bar. That's one reason why Tom and I, and a lot of us were not gay, of course, but the ones who were gay knew that this was the only place we could survive in the open. Otherwise, we'd have to keep it secret. the gay movement. I mean, the gays in San Francisco were out in the open, but after the 60s, they became militant, you know, demanding their rights and things like that. They didn't do that before, you know. And that's another reason why you don't live in New York City, because at that time, the gay bars were down an alleyway into an unmarked door. You had to know where they were. There was no sign or no evidence. You couldn't stumble on them by accident. You had to know about it. But that wasn't true in San Francisco.
In the 50s, it wasn't true?
No, it wasn't. In San Francisco, the gay bars were right out on the street, and you know, they had signs, and their windows were open, and you could look in to see what was going on. And it was a big movement. San Francisco was, that's another reason why I stayed here, is because it was the center of the gay movement. Much more so. You know, New York takes all the credit for their Stonewall riot. That's just one event. You know, we had 20 years of those events, but they get all the credit. Oh, Stonewall broke it all open. You know, well, it did do something, I mean, but they're justly proud of it. But it isn't the only thing that happened. And it isn't the main, it isn't even the main thing that happened. Am I making that sound better than it was? Well, there, one friend who is from Philadelphia and lives in New York City, he criticized San Francisco for it because the police would raid gay bars and arrest everyone, and their names would appear in the Chronicle the next morning, and they, chances are, they'd lose their job and their apartment. That was going on.
Well, there you go. That's not particularly permissive.
No, it isn't at all. And but that's the great Boer world, you know. That's how they would like things to be. Yeah. I mean, there was nothing people were doing wrong in a gay bar. They couldn't arrest them for any crime. They just arrested them because that's where they were. They could put their name in the paper. That was the main point of it. It was true, it happened, but I kind of ignored it. But my friend Michael Roommaker, he was shocked by it. He still is. It was outrageous, but then so many things were outrageous. It wasn't unusually outrageous. The world usually was outrageous. There was, you know, and it wasn't as bad as New York City, where the gay bars had to be hidden. You know, couldn't be out in the open at all. Well, there was a couple of, well, one at least, drag bar in Greenwich Village that was open to the street, and that was it, as far as I know. We had a couple of bars like that in San Francisco, too, in those days. It was a bar called Dolan's, which was just off Bush Street, downtown. And you had to know about it. You couldn't find it by accident. You didn't know where it was going. But it was, it attracted men who were not able to be open about it, you know. They would lose their jobs or their family or something. So that's who was going there. When Alan read Howl at the Sixth Gallery in San Francisco, we knew it the next afternoon. And it was such a sensational thing.
Howl for Carl Solomon. I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness. Starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn looking for an angry fix. Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo and the machinery of night. Who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats, floating across the tops of cities, contemplating jazz. Who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering on tenement roofs, illuminated. Who passed through universities.
most of the people who lived in San Francisco that I knew were artists of one kind or another, and they were all there for the same reason I was, that it was a very livable place and provided lots and lots of opportunity, which no other place in America did. It was its equal. You know, I had connections with a gallery in Chicago, for instance, called the Wells Street Gallery, but that was a very serious gallery run by a group of artists. And they gave each other shows, you know. And they never gave me a show of my own because I wasn't there long enough, but I was in one of their shows. But that didn't, what happened there, they broke up, their main artist went to New York and stayed there. So New York is without doubt, without question, the primary place for an artist to live, if you can take it. And, a lot of people can't take it, including me. So, but San Francisco was very supportive. For instance, the three major museums, art museums, were all free. Yeah, so you could go a lot, you know. If you were at Loose Ends, you just went to a museum and spent a few hours. You didn't have to pay $35 like I did the last time I went to the Museum of Modern Art. I think it was $37. And that was the senior rate. Imagine if I was a student and not over 65. I don't know what I would have paid. Probably $55. Well, this makes it impossible for students or artists to even cope. But it wasn't when I was there. It was the opposite of that. Very supportive. And in San Francisco, the poets and the painters knew each other and were friends with each other. And that's unusual. And sometimes it happens, but not very often. Like in New York, Frank O'Hara, do you know who Frank O'Hara is? Well, he was a major poet while he was alive in New York City, and all his friends were painters. And he wrote about them all the time and visited them. And so he became celebrated, as did his friends become celebrated, because somebody was paying attention to them. And that's what happened. Because that was New York City, and those people had a chance to become well-known, and they did become well-known. I think one of Frank O'Hara's closest friends was Larry Rivers. Larry Rivers is a peculiar kind of painter. He's kind of a primitive. You know, he taught himself how to paint. And He at first he was doing kind of realistic, shocking paintings, like it was the mother-in-law naked, things like that, and he got a lot of attention. In the last years of his life, I doubt if he was painting drug paraphernalia, you know, syringes and things. Don't ask me why. It was a subject matter that not only he knew about, but a lot of other people knew about it. But I don't think it went very far because they weren't good paintings. They're sort of ugly, awful paintings. He should have stuck with his mother-in-law. I'm just being facetious. Bill and I decided that the artists of San Francisco were totally neglected, and they had no way to see each other's work. They had no connection with each other. And so he wanted a salon. And I thought, fuck the salon, let's have a gallery. And that's what we did. We had a gallery. And all the artists that we invited could bring their... First year we did monthly group shows. And we never selected what the artist brought. We held everything the artist brought. Everything. So the artist didn't have to face criticism or disappointment. If he wanted to show something, we would show it. And then when we get to the one-man shows, that again was strictly up to the artist. We as gallery people didn't interfere with that at all. We helped him do it, helped him hang things. But we didn't make selections. And that was what was different about us. Because we were really a gallery for artists. We weren't into it to sell paintings and to become famous to get criticized. That was not the motive at all. The only show that was criticized was an Emmys, and that was because her boyfriend worked at the Chronicle, and he asked the Chronicle critic to review her show, and he did. So that was a fluke, you know. None of the other shows were ever reviewed at all. No, but that's not true. My show was reviewed by Canute in Art Forum. That was because Canute wrote reviews. Monthly reviews for Art Forum, and it's not like a gallery, which is outside. Gallery people are predators on art. You know, they try to promote it in order to sell it, and they don't care. That's all they care about, literally. And they don't help. Oddly enough, in America, they don't help artists. You know, in Europe. The galleries take you on, and from then on, they give you monthly money so you can rent and eat and go to a movie once in a while and buy your materials. And then when you get enough for a show, they give you the show. But in the United States of America, that does not happen to anybody, except maybe it happens with the heart stars. I remember when two or three galleries in below the, what do they call that area below Soho, south of Houston Street. That was, those galleries were really so successful that they could buy for artists. They would, in other words, they would pay artists to show at their place. But that's almost unheard of. But they did. I mean, his main paintings at that time were broken plates glued to the canvas and painted over. He was a waiter somewhere. There were a lot of broken plates in his life. So that's what he did. Here's my show at Buzz. One of the few shows that was photographed. I don't know why we were so anti-camera. We weren't on purpose, I don't think. We just didn't do it. You know, I was working very abstractly. What you do is you find the painting as you're painting. That's what you do. Well, that's San Francisco. San Francisco has many more poets than painters. But painters have art galleries, and galleries have an audience, and so a poet can read in an art gallery and have a little bit of an audience. Now, if you're going into it to become famous and make money, you're going to be disappointed. Because that's an accident if that happens. Julian Schnabel is the artist who did the plates and so on, and was courted by the galleries in the Soho area who were making tons of money. So they bought him a loft, you know. They gave him $5,000, but they gave him a big expensive car, and so on. All this just to get him to show at their place so they could sell his works and make money. But that was no more than three galleries did that. Oh. The other galleries didn't do that. You were talking about the friend of yours who decided after visiting New York City that the art was too difficult to pursue a life in. It is. It is too difficult. And many, many people fall by the wayside. And that's one reason why we did Buzz, is because we were young, we all of us were painting, and we had nowhere to show them, and nobody could see them. So we made a place. As I said earlier, it's a vocation or something. You identify with the whole art world and art history, and you're a part of it. And you do your art. And whether you get reviewed or bought or not, that's another thing. If you want to make money, you do a certain type of art that sells well. Certain kinds of landscapes sell well, and Western art sells well. There are very few things, but those people are not in the capital art world. Not just us, but all of the artists and writers of that period were included in the San Francisco Renaissance. San Francisco Renaissance was a show that somebody gathered displaying San Francisco art all over the city for 1 month. They got the use of every gallery in the city and every space, and they showed all of the artists at one time, and they called it the San Francisco Renaissance. And some of the poets like Duncan and Spicer referred to their work as the San Francisco Renaissance because it came from the Berkeley Renaissance. They called their work in Berkeley the Berkeley Renaissance, and when they moved to San Francisco, they were the San Francisco Renaissance. That's where that idea came from, I think, because it wasn't true. You know, most of the artists shown in the San Francisco Renaissance shows, they were all over town just for 1 month. And alas, I didn't even see them because I had hepatitis at the time and was in bed at home. I couldn't go to shows, but that's what the San Francisco Renaissance is. It's not as real as you might think it is. It included all of the artists of San Francisco, most of whom didn't know each other and didn't show with each other, but that was the one time they did all get to show at the same time. All over town. But most of us denied we were in the beat culture because we felt that the beat culture was really a small handful of writers, Ginsberg and Kerouac, for instance, and three or four other people that they knew intimately. I mean, they were the beat culture. They invented beat, and they were the beat. And then the rest of the culture glommed onto that idea and that word, and they started using it everywhere. And in San Francisco, Herb Cain wrote a daily gossip column. He called it Beatniks because the Sputnik was going up at that time, and we were Beatniks, which means we were suspect people, probably commies, is what it meant. That's what everybody knew that. But by that time, people were arriving in San Francisco to pose as beatniks, because everybody around the country knew about the San Francisco scene, and they joined it, and they didn't join it in a genuine way, like doing their art and shutting up. They declared themselves beatniks, and they were, you know, self-declared. That's why Joanne and people I knew resisted being called that. And Joanne is more of a beatnik than any of us because she was married to Gary Snyder, and she traveled in India with Allen Ginsberg, and she was close friends with Philip Whalen. All these are beat writers, the second generation of beat writers. And so that's why she was called beat, but not beatnik, beat. But she always denied it, you know. So finally she got tired of denying it and just went along with it.
Peter, Sam Burr is left on the island. The others left Thursday when Tom came back from St. Kitts. Someone stole the head of NX. That was a monkey skull. The hermit's crabs having cleaned her bones. An open address by Peter. Who has stolen her head? I'm going to search their luggage to be left in her natural place. She rose up in white raiment. the feminine spirit escaped as the body began to lose its life. Some time ago, caught, rammed through with a spear, and still lies dying in a black plastic bucket, flopping over the sign I sing, Om Shri Maitreya, what for the soul of a dying fish? Stick a knife in its brain. Now it is meat, fish meat. You can tell I'm not much of a fisher, so this is the first time someone before my eyes actually caught a fish. I had to go through a great savior routine and pray.
But now, looking back, I realize we were beatniks anyway, San Francisco artists who had communist leanings and were subversive. Yes, we were. Kerouac invented that word. He took it from beatitude. Ooh. He thought he and Ginsberg and his friends, they were like Latter-day Saints. So the beatitude, they became the beats from that. I don't know if you know that. But in San Francisco, we became subversive communists by Herb King calling us beatniks. But they're actually one of the underground publications is called Beatitude. Kerouac was a wonderful person, but he was a little bit naive. You know, he had very interesting friends, but he really didn't keep up with them that much. He was at home taking care of his mother. And then his novels became very famous, and he made a lot of money. So he was able to buy his mother a house out on Long Island and drink himself to death. That was his success.
Yeah.
But he's one of the most likable of the beats, really. I mean, he's got the biggest body of work, and he's the most read of them all. Ginsberg is the most influential one, but Kerouac is very important. And there was also a group of people from, what was that college in Southern Oregon? Reed College?
Reed, yeah.
Yeah, that's where a number of people, who were they? Philip Whalen was from Reed, and Lou Welch was from Reed, and what's his name? Joanne Marion, what was his name? Gary Snyder. Those are three important writers who were friends from Reed. They knew each other, and they kept up with each other. And from Fort Wayne, we had me and Tom and Lou Ellingham, and then later my brother came. So we had a Fort Wayne element. To our scene. And I don't know why that. I think it was because Fort Wayne, for one thing, was a very. It was sort of like. It was a little bit better than Andy Warhol's upbringing in Pittsburgh, but not much. It was almost at that level. And if my family had been immigrants, I would have been at his level. But my family go back before the revolution, so I'm not an immigrant. But we were rural people who finally got elbowed out of the rural scene and came into town and got factory jobs. That's what we did. Well, my father was born south of Fort Wayne in the country, and then he was a sickly baby, and the doctor said that my grandparents had to take him to a dry climate or he would die. So of all places, they took him to Saskatchewan. Saskatchewan was offering, what do you call it, when you claim land and you get the rights to it by building a house and planting a field. They could do that. They didn't have to have any money. They just had to get to Saskatchewan and stake out a claim, and they did. They lived there 20 years. My father was raised, you know, on a almost a wilderness farm. Right now, I think it's it is included in a big national park. My father was a child, a baby, when he went there, and he was raised there. But then my grandfather was a young man, and he was the, you know, my grandfather and my grandmother were very, very highly motivated people. But they were from the country, and they didn't have good enough education to get out of menial jobs. And that's where they were. But they really buckled down, and they saved their money, and they clawed their way into the lower middle class. That's what they did. It's good for them. And that photograph you saw of my grandfather and the other men, they're all his friends, and that's a real event. I mean, they did go out there and hunt, but it was a staged event, you know, for a magazine to promote travel to Canada. That's what it was about. But I didn't know that growing up. I thought, oh, this is where my grandfather lived. I only found out about that recently, that it was a staged photograph. The Dust Bowl started in Canada, and they went bankrupt in the early part of the Dust Bowl, which eventually hit the United States. You know, hit Canada's is the most famous, but the Idaho and so forth, and the Dakotas, all those places, all those rural areas went bust, bankrupt. There was nothing left for them. And if you still go through those areas, you see mostly empty places. You know, they're falling apart now. But it never revived, you know. Yeah. What my grandparents did is when the farm wasn't helping them, they rented a big house in Saskatchewan and Fort Battleford? I don't know the town. It was a rather big town near their homestead, and they ran a hotel. But that wasn't very profitable either. So eventually they had to return to Fort Wayne, which was where they were from. And you had to get out, you know, or die. There wasn't any survival staying there. There still isn't. Saskatchewan is the only province that has an active Communist Party for that reason. People can't make it individually. You have to cooperate to make it. So that's still true there. But Canada doesn't worry about things like that. Canada's, you know, well, yeah, they're communists, so what? They make a good hamburger, you know. We don't have a recognizable painting culture in the present time. Haven't had. I think the last time we had a painting culture might have been in France with the realists into the Impressionists. Impressionists are also realists, you know. They always depict exactly what they see, except they do it in such a way that people are confused by it. But they are definitely realists. But after that was over, then artists, you know, you think of Cézanne, I think for the first time he had a show, he was about 2 years from his death, you know. Van Gogh, of course, you know, never had a show and sold one painting in his whole life. He painted 800 paintings in the center of the art world. He sold one. And I think that was to his brother. We discussed it at one point that we were the last genuine artists who were ever going to be on the planet, because the world at large was totally alien to the artist, and we never thought it would come back, but it did. You know, one of the most surprising things is the flower children, the hippies. their art was sort of not very deep, but it was art, and they brought that all back. And they were middle-class kids who had parents who were sending them money so they could buy, you know, marijuana. And they revived the general interest in art, really. But I was convinced that we were right, that we were the last. There wasn't going to be any after us, it was be over with. I was 63 and retired. I got my retirement money. And that was also, I remember that because I applied for retirement money in Oakland, where I was living with my brother. And Oakland is used to this kind of a scene. For instance, when I said I was going to apply for retirement, she says, "You're not trying to work, are you, honey?" You know, that wouldn't be said in San Francisco. You have to justify yourself in San Francisco, but in Oakland, they understand. The rents in San Francisco are way, I mean, I couldn't possibly afford anything in San Francisco. I looked at the place like, what? It was called a studio apartment, and it was $500. I thought, well, I'm in luck. You know what it was? It was an unremodeled garage in a downtown alley, and I had to get to it by going through the guy's place. He was an architect who was renting me the garage for $500. And not the whole garage. He reserved a corner of it for his dark room. So I started up Highway 1 because I you know, lived in Bodega Bay and Milenas. So I thought, well, I'll find a place to live in those places that I know. But there wasn't anything. But I got to Mendocino. I found an apartment within an hour. Moved in. It was that easy. I lived out at Pikeville for 21 years. And I lived in Fort Bragg for at least 2 years before I moved out there. So it's been a long time. This is not a sophisticated place, but it's much more sophisticated than it would have been, you know, 30 years ago. People know what's going on now. And so that's another reason I came up here. I had an income. Also, I had rights. I had medical rights. I paid nothing for medicine or doctor's bills or operations. All that was covered. So I was well off. You know, I was getting about $900 a month retirement. And that's all I needed. My rent was $300, so I could get by. It was easy. But $900 in San Francisco would have got me nothing. At all. And I don't regret it because I was ready to retire to the country. You know, it's
the country.
It's been a very pleasant time here. I don't regret it at all. Also, the population doesn't think you're unusual. They know about you. They've seen other artists. So, you know, it's nothing unusual. It wasn't true in the mid-70s when I lived in Albion. Fort Bragg was hostile to me, you know. I don't know why they were. I don't know what they saw in me. But they were very hostile. They didn't want me to even shop here. And I think it was because they were hostile to Albion people. There were a lot of hippies in Albion. That was a place where hippies who had a little money could buy a place. And there were hippies outnumbered everybody else. A lot of the artists are retired people who all their lives wanted to be an artist, and now they can be. They have the time to do it. And that's what's true. The Mendocino Art Center, that's what you got mostly there. And there are teachers who came from all over the country to Mendocino. Art is art. I mean, it has a long history. It goes back to the caves. It always has. And that's where artists do. I mean, that's what I think of. I think of all the art that's gone before me. And I'm like, part of that. That's enough. You know, if you're doing that, that's plenty.